especially in those days, was radio talk show hosts that would say, call in, please call. We want to hear from you. We want to hear from you. And so I'd say, okay. I'd pull over off the freeway. Are we going live?
Yeah.
Okay, we're live. All right, ladies and gentlemen, we're not only live on Crusade Radio, but we're live on Congressional Prayer Conference of Washington, D.C. This is the Wiley Drake Show. If you hear something tonight that you like or don't like, you're welcome to call us during the show. I'm going to give you that number and access code, and you can call in. And if later you want to go back and listen to what we had to say and check us out, we'll be up in the archives. As soon as we finish this program, my executive producer, Jaime Guillen, will publish it, as they say in the business. It will be published to our archives. It will also be published to YouTube. And you can go back to YouTube or our archive and listen to it again if you would so desire. Now, we're live on the air, and we have guests in the studio, and we're going to introduce our guests in just a few moments. And but if you'd like to call, here's how you call in. If you're in Northern California and want to use a landline, old-fashioned telephone line, call 559-592-5961, and the studio line will answer you. Now, if you'd like to call in and be live on this audio version of the meeting, call 712-432-1690. 712-432-1690. And put in your access code 399-430-pound. And I mentioned before that early on I would call in on a radio show and they would beg and plead with people to call in. And I'd call in and they'd say, I'm sorry, Mr. Limbaugh is not available right now. What would you like to talk about? And I'd say, well, I'd like to talk about the Bible. Okay, thank you. We'll put you on hold. We'll get back to you. 10 minutes, 15 minutes, 20 minutes later, they'd come on and say, Mr. Drake, Mr. Limbaugh is not discussing the Bible today. Therefore, thank you for your call. Goodbye. And they'd hang up on me. Well, I got mad about that several times and found out that they choose and pick and choose. And I said, if I ever have a radio show, if I ever have a TV show, I'm not going to screen the caller. So, if you call in right now on the landline, on the 712 line, nobody's going to say, what do you want to talk about? Except me. I answer the phone. You'll come live right in on the line. So, with that in mind, we're going to go ahead into our show. We're 5 minutes early, but that's okay. Ladies and gentlemen, I have with me a gentleman that I have a great deal of respect for, and I'm not saying that just because he's sitting here beside me with a big stick in his hand, making sure I say the right. No, I'm only kidding. But I do have a great deal of respect for him. He is one of the persons involved in an organization called Litigation Logistics Incorporated, and his name is Stephen Davis. Stephen Davis, good evening. God bless you, and welcome to the show.
Hello again, Pastor Drake. How are you doing?
I'm doing absolutely fantastic, and I want you to tell our people a little bit more about you and about the organization, and then we want to move very quickly into the topic of the hour. So I'm going to ask you to introduce the organization, and then I want you to introduce the topic, and I may jump in there, as you quite often know, and ask you a question or push you in a certain direction. But ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the show tonight, Mr., my buddy, my friend, Stephen Davis. Stephen, God bless you and welcome to the show.
Thank you, sir.
Go ahead and introduce the organization and then introduce the topic for the night.
The organizations you're going to hear about tonight are three, one of which is Litigation Logistics Group Incorporated. Our website is LLGESQ.com. A division of that corporation is the Center for Second Amendment Studies. And if you go to the website and you start going down through it, you will find a place where you can click on that, and that'll take you to what the center is all about. The Litigation Logistics Group and the Center for Second Amendment Studies is associated with another company by the name of CATS, which is Civilian Arms Training Source. What we do is we teach people, A, how to survive gunfights, and then after you survive the gunfight, how the heck do you survive the legal system? Because it doesn't do any good to be able to save your life and then spend the rest of it in prison. That's really an unpleasant thing to do.
Amen.
I'm going to suggest to the pastor tonight the name of this show, because that way he puts it into his archive so we can find it. And the name of this show, which is going to be extremely interesting, is the CDC Gun Report. So that's Charlie Delta Charlie Gun Report. And you may think, what the heck does the Center for Disease Control in Atlanta have anything to do with guns?
That's exactly what's going to be my first question. What in the world does the CDC have to do with guns?
Well, this may come as a shock to you, but certain chapters of our political establishment in the United States see guns as a disease.
Mm.
And they said, well, you know, we have people that are getting hurt and shot and killed, and so that's a disease, so we want to go into disease control. So we're going to have the Center for Disease Control do a report on gun violence and gun injuries. And you think, okay, I am totally confused. Well, it gets better. The report that we are going to discuss tonight and all of the comments on the report that we're going to discuss tonight is called Priorities for Research to Reduce the Threat of Firearm-Related Violence. And it was released in June of 2013. So you can go on, you can run the CDC gun report on the internet, or you can run the name that we just gave you, and it will pull that up. However, there are more interesting things to look at, because that report is 120 pages long, and it has a ton of credentialed investigators, researchers, commentators in it. They went through a great deal of research to come up with the point. And the problem was, it's not the point that President Obama wanted.
Now, before you go any further into the report or into the information, if some of our people were listening and they thought, well, I wonder what they're going to talk about on the Wiley Drake Show today, and they heard about it and they got their ears pricked to listen, and now all of a sudden they're saying, well, wait a minute, he talked about a website and he gave that a while ago, and I didn't write that down. So, for those of us that didn't write it down, give us those websites one more time, would you?
The primary website is for Litigation Logistics Group is LLGESQ.com. And obviously that stands for Litigation Logistics Group Esquire, which means we're legal. That's what we do. On that website is a section called the Center for Second Amendment Studies. So go to the LOG website, scroll down, you'll find that when you click on it. That takes you to the website on that. The other website that we talk about is for Civilian Arms Training Source. And if you put in www.civilianarmstrainingsource, all one word, .com, then that takes you to their website, which has a whole bunch of really cool stuff in it, including pictures of yours truly on it.
Oh,
that's another
right.
issue. The breakdown of what the two groups do is CATS, Civilian Arms Training Source, they teach you how to survive the gunfight. In other words, if you're in your home, if you're in a business, if you are a concealed weapons permit holder, and the unspeakable happens, and you are suddenly confronted by an armed bad guy, how do you survive that fight?
All right, now we're going to talk about that in just a few moments, but before we do, we have a caller on the line. Caller, are you there?
Brother Shorty.
Brother Shorty, God bless you, my friend. We're talking about the CDC and the gun report that they have, and I know that you are a Second Amendment man, and I know you are a gun man, and I know you're a very godly man. But hang on with us just for a moment. You're welcome to ask any questions. We have Stephen Davis on with us with Litigation Logistics Esquire.com. And they're the folk that are two things we're talking about. One is surviving the gunfight, i.e. how to defend yourself. And number two, how to survive the legal fight when the gunfight's over. So Stephen Davis is going to be explaining some of that to us. And I thought it sort of strange when he talked about, we want to talk about the CDC. That's the Center for Disease Control. Well, there are some people that are warped in their mind to think that people that like guns and people that want to use guns have a disease. Well, they don't have a disease, but we're going to talk about that tonight. Do we have another caller on the line?
Yes, all right, let me call you back, Joel.
I'm sorry?
Yes, you do.
Yeah, we're live on the television show. If you'd like to be on, you can stay on and talk. Or if you'd like, you can just go to your computer and watch or listen, whatever your desire is. Well, we certainly would like to have your story, and we take those stories all the time. But let me just say this today. We have a little different bent today. That doesn't mean we're not interested. We are interested. We're fighting, and we're fighting against CPS and a lot of the systems where these dear, dear children have been taken away from their parents. Here's what I would suggest you do. I would suggest you get your pen and let me give you my email address, and you email to me your case story. It doesn't have to be professionally done or anything. Just sit down at your keyboard and tell us your story and put it in email form and email it to me, and then we'll get back with you and have you come on the program when we're talking about that particular subject. So, I don't want to put you off, and it is very, very important that we hear from you. Have you got your pen and ready to write?
Yes, sir.
My email is Wiley. That's W-I-L-E-Y, W-I-L-E-Y. Write it down twice. Wiley, Wiley, at
okay.
Wiley, Wiley, at att.net. Now, that ATT, if my southern accent's making it sound funny, I apologize, but ATT is like the phone company, those letters for the phone company. So it's Wiley Wiley at ATT.net. And if you send me an email to that address, if you would put in the subject line CPS. Here in California, they call it Child Protective Services. I know it's different in other states. But if you just put that subject in there, I promise you, I'll read your email, I'll call and put your phone number in there so I can reach you, and I'll email you or phone you, talk to you about your case, and then at another show, we do two shows a day, one at 9 a.m. and one at 5 p.m. What area code are you, I mean, what time zone are you in? Ma'am, where are you located? Okay, she may have gone on mute. We may have lost her. But our time zone is the West Coast, of course. And this show is on at noon every day, D.C. time. And then at this hour, 8 p.m. D.C. time. And so, ma'am, if you send me an email, we'd be glad to consider your case. Now, with that in mind, let's get back to our main topic, and that is CDC gun report. And Brother Stephen Davis was talking to us about the fact that they've made a very thorough, I understand, a report. Share with us a little bit about that.
Before I get started on that, because you had asked me to do it and I unfortunately didn't, so I'll have to make amends and go from there. Let me give you a little more of my background.
Good.
I'm a retired law enforcement officer. I retired as a deputy chief. I was the head of a fire marshal division when we did the bomb arson investigations. I was an instructor at the National Fire Academy for FEMA back in Emmitsburg, Maryland. I worked my way up through lieutenant colonel with the United States Air Force, CAP. And with that group, I did...
CAP, now for those of us that aren't military background, CAP stands for Civil Air Patrol?
Absolutely.
All right, go right ahead.
And what's interesting about the Civil Air Patrol is the government uses it as a great way to get around the Posse Comitatus Act. Because although it is theoretically a civilian organization, by using it to do the counter-narcotics and other things the military isn't allowed to do, it allows the Air Force to do counter-narcotics operations and not run afoul of the Posse Comitatus Act, which says that the military cannot enforce laws against civilians.
Okay. All right, now, go right ahead. We're talking about you were involved with CAP.
And I was a command pilot.
Okay.
I was a JAG officer.
Now, yeah. JAG officer, I know what it is because I'm former Navy. But tell our listening audience that might not be as keenly aware of terminology, what's a JAG officer?
If you ever watched a television program that was called JAG, then you figured out what it was. JAG is the military terminology for an attorney, and it stands for Judge, Advocate, General. Amen. So if somebody says that they're a JAG officer, they're Judge, Advocate, General. They are an attorney for the military.
Amen.
I was the state leading attorney, the chief counsel for the California wing, and worked my way up to lieutenant colonel, 05 for the military people. For the civilians, it's the guy with a little silver leaf on his collar. And above him is a bird colonel, below him is a major. And that's the way we are and stuff. I am a graduate of the University of Laverne School of Law. I have my doctorate from there.
Yeah.
Of course, it's the Church of the Brethren School, which I take great pride in.
This is Pastor Wiley.
And
we're on a TV program right now. Can you call me back at the
Did a great deal of litigation, both representing police officers who got in trouble, representing people who got injured. Now what we're working on is on class action wage cases where companies are not paying their employees. And that gets really interesting. If you have any questions on that, go to our website. We'll talk about it. Because I am both the chief professor for the Center for Second Amendment Studies, and myself and my boss, who is the president, Linda Jones, we teach the post-shooting class. We teach that class here at Wiley Drake's Chapel. We also have other places that we teach it. Go on to our website. You'll find it. For example, coming up this Saturday, the 21st of February, we're going to be doing one down in Murrieta. And then we have another one coming up next month in Fontana at the 15 Freeway and Baseline at Logan's Roadhouse and stuff. I'm also the range safety officer for CATS, so I do my job to make sure that people don't shoot themselves while they're going to the training.
Good idea.
Things, let me tell you, it can get scary. One of the things that we try to do in our class, both in the shooting class, one other thing, CATS is also doing the concealed weapons permit classes for Orange County. And so I help with some advice on that one. My job is to make sure that they, both our group and their group, are up to speed on what the latest issues on Second Amendment, self-defense, concealed carry issue is, so that we can advise people when, where, and how to do it, what's the best way to do it, what are the problems you have by doing it. And so I had gotten a call in regards to what was the current policy on things, and so I started doing some investigation, and lo and behold, I came up with this CDC report. Again, CDC stands for the Center for Disease Control, and so you'd wonder, what the heck are they doing a gun report? As I had said earlier, I will say it again, the report that they wrote is Priorities for Research to Reduce the Threat of Firearm-Related Violence, and it was released in June of 2013. It turns out that it was based on an order from President Obama that he was using the Sandy Hook incident to order the CDC to start talking about the problem of gun violence. We are not going to talk about whether or not we have all of the true facts on the Sandy Hook incident. That's for a different show on a different day, and I understand there's a lot of opinion in both directions, but still, the triggering excuse event for the CDC report was the Sandy Hook incident. And that was the one where allegedly there was a whole bunch of kids that were shot at a elementary school, and that's how we got to this. So the CDC does a very thorough, a very honest report, and unfortunately, they came up with a conclusion that was absolutely contrary to what the government has been trying to sell us and what Obama has been trying to sell us. Rather than read the 120-page report, what I would suggest is go to gunsandammomagazine.com. Guns and Ammo, very famous shooting magazine. If you go to Guns and Ammo website and you search for the CDC report, you're going to come up with their article on it, and their article is what is really interesting. So, first of all, they have the points that was the big argument that the anti-gun establishment tries to use, and they were able to take it apart one by one. The first thing that they said was that armed citizens are less likely to be injured by an attacker. Well, obviously, you think, well, if you just, you know, do what the bad guy wants you to do and you obey the bad guy's order, the bad guy's just going to get what he wants from you, he's going to leave you alone. It doesn't happen that way. What they found is that there's consistently lower injuries among gun-using crime victims compared to other victims that use self-protective strategies. In other words, if you have a gun and you use it to protect yourself, there's less chance you're going to get hurt. There is some additional studies on that that says that if you submit to the bad guy, you're going to get hurt a lot more. And so that's a kind of an oopsie that the government doesn't like to tell you. Another thing that came out that was completely contrary to what the government was telling us is that defensive use of guns are common. You make it sound like, when you look at it, that no, it doesn't happen very often, and you know, we have the police and the police will protect us, and that's a really good thing. That's not what the CDC report came up with. What the CDC report came up with is almost all national surveys estimates indicate defensive gun use by victims are at least as common as offensive uses by criminals, with the estimates of annual use ranging from 500,000 to more than 3 million per year. That is in the context of 300,000 violent crimes involving firearms, and they use that in the 2008 era. So what they're telling you is that depending on which study you're looking at.
Let me stop you just for a minute. I'm dealing with a technical difficulty here. Wendy, are you on the line with us?
Yes, finally. I've been trying to call in for about 13 minutes now, Pastor.
I apologize for that. Don't know what happened. We had a technical snag somewhere, but I've corrected it now, and you're live on the air with us. But we're talking to Stephen Davis right now, and we're talking about the CDC gun control report, and he's been doing a great, great job with that, and we're going to continue with that. So if you would just hold on, let him go ahead with that report. And then if you'd like to hang on and listen in, you're welcome to do so. You're welcome to participate. But we are sort of going in that direction right now. So hang on, Wendy, and the rest of you. We are live here on the line with you. And Brother Stephen Davis, I apologize. We had a technical snag here somewhere. Not sure what's going on. But go ahead with your report.
Thank you, sir. So, depending on what report you look at, and the CDC study cites a lot of different reports, between 500,000, in other words, a half a million events, to up to 3 million events per year, citizens, armed citizens, use guns to protect themselves, which results in less injuries to them, less crime, obviously. And what really gets scary is when you take those numbers and you divide them by 365. What you wind up with is you wind up with a number of armed citizen protection incidents per day that are in the thousands.
Unbelievable.
Now, the issue is, and the report talks about it a lot, is that if you're successful in defending yourself, and that may just be by showing the firearm, and all of a sudden the bad guy says, I want to go pick on somebody else, this guy's got a gun, or even better, this woman has a gun, there's nothing that will prevent a rape case like a Colt 45, in my humble opinion. So needless to say, that's an interesting issue. So when you start looking at that, the reason why you don't hear this incredible number of events on the media is, one, the primary media is slightly slanted against firearms, and number two, it doesn't mean the shots have fired, it doesn't mean that people were injured. So the fact that an armed citizen, by showing his weapon, stopped a crime and the bad guy left, is not really newsworthy. It doesn't get people all excited.
It's not the blood and guts and the glory that we see in some of the things where somebody is shot to death, or somebody run over with a car or whatever it is. not that kind of excitement that they like on the news.
Oh, absolutely. That media attraction brings us up to point number three that Guns and Ammo noted in the report. Point number three is that mass shootings and accidental firearm deaths account for a small fraction of gun-related deaths, and both are declining. Now, if you realize that the triggering event for this report was the Sandy Hook shooting, and you think, okay, then they don't want to talk about all these mass shootings and all these really bad things happening, and the trouble is they're not happening that often and stuff. Certainly they make the news. Certainly a mass shooting is a very unhappy event, but they make it sound like it's something that happens on a regular basis, and the answer is it doesn't happen very often at all. The number of public mass shootings of this type that occurred in Sandy Hook, assuming that it did, an elementary school, is a very small fraction of all firearm-related death. Since 1983, so we're talking almost 30 years ago, there's only been 78 events in which four or more individuals have been killed by a single perpetrator. Okay, that's kind of small. There have been resulted in 547 victims and 476 injured persons. Okay, well, that sounds like a lot of numbers until you look at the number of people that are killed in automobile accidents each year, which rapidly approaches 50,000 being killed and injured. So if in 30 years we have 500 people killed and 400 people injured, compared to a heck of a lot more killed and injured in automobile accidents, all of a sudden, firearms maybe aren't as dangerous as we think they are.
Well, and that's exactly the whole point. That's why we deal, ladies and gentlemen, on this program, not only with Child Protective Service cases and different kinds of cases, but we deal with cases where the government is using their reports and their reporting to slant something, to scare people away from something. And I think that's exactly what the CDC gun report's intentions were, and we need to know more about that. That's why we have Stephen Davis on with us. Go ahead with your report.
One of the things that they want you to believe is that guns are inherently dangerous, and I've heard stories everywhere from they're too complex for the common citizen to be able to handle, up to the fact that if you touch a gun, you're possessed by the devil and you're immediately going to go out and do bad things. Neither one of those are true. Well, maybe one of them is true. The number of unintentional deaths due to firearm-related incidents account for less than 1% of all unintentional fatalities in 2010. So in 2010, you have 99% better chance of dying through some other way besides a firearm. You only have 1%. So needless to say, that could lead to anything from kitchen accidents to drug overdoses to automobile accidents, all of which seem to be much more dangerous than firearm incidents.
Amen. Hang on there just for a minute. Did we have another caller on the line that just joined us? If you'd like to identify yourself, you're welcome to do so. You certainly don't have to, but go ahead if you'd like. All right, we're going to go ahead. We're doing a report tonight with Brother Stephen Davis, and he's talked about his background and credentials and so forth. But we're dealing with this whole subject of the CDC's report, the gun report. And I was surprised when I heard about the fact that the CDC, the Center for Disease Control, was dealing with this gun issue. But Brother Stephen's been pointing out to us, in all honesty, how safe weapons are, how safe guns are. Yes, a gun can kill, but, you know, the age-old cliche almost is, guns don't kill people, people kill people. And that's really true. And we need to understand that this report is very, very important. Tell us a little bit more, Stephen, about that report and how they can get that report if they would like to see it.
One of the unbelievably interesting things about the report, and more importantly, the conclusion that was reached in the report, is after Heller versus the District of Columbia was handed down by the United States Supreme Court, which determined that the Second Amendment was an individual right, not a state right. And you have to remember, for 173 years, the government was arguing that the Second Amendment merely gave states the right to have militias. Mm-hmm. And then the Supreme Court, in an excellent history lesson and study in the Heller, H-E-L-L-E-R, versus the District of Columbia, published their decision, and lo and behold, said that the Second Amendment is an individual right to self-protection. And that was like, okay, that's 173 years of history that just changed. So the pro-gun people obviously were very ecstatic about it. The anti-gun people were having heart attacks. And then we had two more cases come down. We had the McDonald's versus the city of Chicago case and the Purietta versus San Diego case. What happened in the McDonald San Diego case was that the city of, the McDonald versus Chicago case, sorry about that, was that the city of Chicago had decided that they were going to prohibit firearms in the city limits. And they were not the only ones that did that. Washington, D.C., our nation's capital, prohibited firearms there. Chicago was one of them. We all know about New York, which is the really not good. And so as a result of that, the Chicago said, well, we don't care what the United States Supreme Court said. We're still not going to allow guns here. A consortium of pro-gun advocates sued the city, went up to the Supreme Court. Supreme Court said, guess what? Because it is a Second Amendment under the Bill of Rights, the 14th Amendment controls, and that means that it is applicable to states, counties, and cities. And so they flat told Chicago, you can't do that. Okay, that gets interesting. So then the anti-gunners, what they wanted to do is they're going to come up with, guess what? Unless you can cite a very specific threat to you, you can't have a concealed weapons permit.
Unbelievable.
Well, here's what that's interesting. Pastor Drake, you're a brave man, aren't you?
Well, I try to be.
Okay, if you were going to go someplace and you knew that when you got there you were going to get shot, would you go there?
Probably not.
Thank you. So the problem is how in the world can you predict that you're going to be assaulted, you're going to be shot, given what the public is like nowadays and the constant crime you hear? Wouldn't it be a better idea that you can carry your own defensive firearm and save your life that way? The bumper sticker for that, which is great, is when seconds count, the police are only minutes away.
That makes a lot of sense. And I remember a history lesson that I think is very appropriate for this very thing that we're talking about. And that is, I had the privilege in my early career to serve at Pearl Harbor, not during the war, but I'm not that old, but I did serve in the Navy at Pearl Harbor, and I heard a little bit about Pearl Harbor. And I remember listening to an interview with...
we are not available now. Please leave your name and phone number after the beep. We will return your call.
Let me get this phone out of here. Well, the reason I bring it up is that I did happen to serve in Pearl Harbor. I was there in the 60s, but... I got interested, of course, in Pearl Harbor and the history. And part of the history that I was interested in was an interview that Hirohito did with a member of the press many, many years after the war. And they said, you know, you attacked very successfully Pearl Harbor. And you went in and just about wiped out the Navy there at Pearl Harbor. Why didn't you just continue on across the ocean and to the West Coast, California and so forth? Why didn't you just go on in and take the whole of the United States? And Hirohito said his people reported to him that the people in America were armed, and we're not going into America if they're armed. And so they didn't come on over in that war. And that was because the fear that American citizens were armed, that every home had a weapon in it. And, of course, they did, and that indeed made a big difference. So this whole concept that weapons are bad and that only bad people have weapons and so forth is just absolutely ridiculous. So go ahead with your report.
Well, on that subject, there's two things I'll comment on. First of all, that rumor, legend, story was the basis for the movie Red Dawn. So if you want to go see Red Dawn, where the Russians came in and invaded, and unfortunately they met armed citizens, very interesting study on that issue. Number two is one of the things the government's not real good about telling you about because they don't like the numbers, is there are 300 million privately owned firearms in the United States. In other words, you have almost more firearms than we have people, depending on how you count the people and stuff. And so you would think that with that many firearms, we'd have a heck of a lot more problems if the anti-gun people were correct as to the corrupting influence of firearms. Well, obviously, it's not a problem.
That's right.
And that brings us to the next item that was in the report that Guns and Ammo noted, which is interventions, i.e. gun control, such as background checks, assault rifle bans, gun-free zones, produced only mixed results. Mm-hmm. Whether gun restrictions reduce firearm-related violence is an unresolved issue. Okay. The report could not include whether the passage of right to carry laws decrease or increase violent crime. Now, why that's interesting is there is now a whole bunch of new studies that have come out that in every community in which right to carry laws have passed, crime has gone down significantly. That figure has gone anywhere from a 50% reduction in crime to an 80% reduction in crime.
Well, folks, I'm not an expert in this field, but I'll tell you something. You don't have to be a rocket scientist or an expert to understand that when people are armed, the bad guys are not going to be as quick to go in and steal or rape or plunder or do anything because they're afraid, hey, those people are going to stand up for themselves and they're going to defend themselves. And so you don't have to be totally that far advanced to understand that, folks, if you have a weapon in the home, that protects you. And the bad guys are going to say, hey, if they got weapons, I don't want to go in there. And that's why the bad guys don't want anybody but them to have guns.
And one of the issues that we push so strenuously is if you have made the personal decision that you're going to use a firearm to defend yourself, your family, your business, or go all the way and get a concealed weapons permit, don't do that unless you have the correct, proper training to be able to do it safely, take the bad guy out, not take out grandma next door, which is really depressing when that happens, and do this in the appropriate manner. That's why we so stress the training that both CATS and the Center for Second Amendment Studies does.
Now, folks, one of the things that we do, we agree with that. We agree that it could be done and should be done safely. I happen to have concealed weapons permits that I have applied for and I got qualified for. I also am a security guard, and I carry a weapon as a security guard and so forth. But I did all of that because I wanted to be capable of doing what I needed to do. And so we as a church, some people find that unusual, but we as a church allow our facility to be used to do that kind of training. And I want to ask Brother Stephen Davis, if you would, to share with us a little bit about the one-day training course that we have here at our church periodically. Tell our listening audience basically what they'll be trained in and how they'll be trained in that all-day course.
Again, you can go to our website, which is the LLGESQ.com, and go to the Center for Second Amendment Studies, and the name of the course is really simple. How do you survive the legal system after you shoot the bad guy? The boss... President Jones did some really good artwork with that. I like it a lot and stuff. So it tells the story, but at the same time shows a little bit of artistic bent. What we do is we walk you through how you survive the legal system from the 911 phone call after the shooting takes place all the way through the end of the court system.
Now, folks, we've heard some horror stories over the years, and I'm sure you have, where someone defends their home, they shoot someone that was about to shoot them or about to stab them or rape them or whatever, and of course the scenario is it occurs, the shooting occurs, they call 911. Now that's the first step. that you need to do it right.
And unfortunately, that's where the bad stuff can start happening if you don't know what to say and what not to say during the 911 phone call.
Right, right. And that's what you learn in this course. You learn step number one is, before you call 911, have your notepad there with what you're to say, what you're not to say. Because depending upon what you say or do not say, will determine whether or not you walk away and they say, yes, it was a justified shooting, or you walk away with a lot of complications, you walk away with lawsuits, you walk away with all kind of problems, and it all is determined about where you lay your foundation, if you will, from that 911 call. And you learn that in this course. And we allow them to come here to our church, check with us, check with their website, find out when they have these seminars. And it's a long one-day seminar, but it's very thorough, and we encourage you to be involved in it. And I've attended several of them, even though I'd already attended before, but they're always very worthwhile again and again, and so I would encourage you to do that. So go to that website or check with me. Check with us here at the church, either one. Go ahead, Brother Davis.
Of course, I'll introduce at this time the fact that Pastor Drake gave us, in essence, our motto, which was Luke 22, 36 through 38, which is sell your garment and buy a sword.
Yeah, amen.
So we agree with that 100%, obviously. And it was interesting when the Lord asked, okay, are we covered there? And their response was, yeah, we got two swords. So needless to say, they were double covered when it came to that.
That's right.
The other thing that we do is we have a scenario. And let me back up one thing and then we'll go to the scenario. The other thing we have, we've gotten a little more aggressive on defending citizens who use guns to defend themselves. We have an ERT, that is an emergency response team. After you dial 911, the next thing you do is you call our 24-hour numbers, and an attorney, an expert on use of force, and a communications expert is going to show up at your scene, and our job is to make sure that the police are very nice to you. Obviously, the police have a job to do, and we certainly expect them to do their job,
amen,
but there's no reason why they can't be polite and nice to you while they're doing their job. And so it makes things a little more interesting. We pride ourselves on that because although there are several other legal defense plans that you can buy where they will provide you with attorneys, they will pay judgments against you, they would produce some legal information for you, they are not there at the scene as fast as we are. And
that's
so
right.
We're a little happy when it comes to that.
And that's ERT, Emergency Response Team, right?
Absolutely.
Amen. And that's very necessary, folks.
Very much so. Because you are not going to be in a normal state of mind after you just got done shooting somebody.
That's right.
One of the things you learn in CATS is the body alarm response. And what we do is we take you from white, which is sitting there drinking your beer, watching television, going all the way up to red, which is, oh my God, the world's coming to an end. Hopefully we keep you out of black, and we don't like talking about black. But it's going to take you anywhere from 24 hours to 48 hours to recover after you've been through that system. Can you wind up with some post-traumatic stress disorder as a result of it? Absolutely. It is never pleasant to have to kill another human being.
That's right.
It's always something that should be avoided if you can't avoid it. But when you are pushed to the limits and you have to do it, that's obviously something you're going to have to deal with afterwards.
That's right.
The next thing we do is we have, and surprisingly the most popular part of the class, is a scenario in which we have our shooter, which happens to be our president, Linda Jones, who winds up getting in a horrendously bad incident in a 7-Eleven, and she winds up getting drugged downtown by the police, and the police are really unhappy that this kind, sweet, wonderful, Christian-believing woman kills somebody, and they're going to go after her. And so they run her through an interrogation that is unpleasant, to say the least. We have tried to introduce the fact that we expect her to get beat with a wet phone book. We haven't been able to do that yet. We do have the phone book on the table. And so if you remember the old police dramas, they used to use that because it doesn't leave marks. But we haven't done it yet. One of the things we found out when we asked the students after the classes, what more would you like from us? They said, we want to be able to ask questions during that scenario. And we said, okay. So in our class, we run by that scenario twice. One without questions, second time with questions. And then go into it as much as they wish. That gives you the feeling of what's going on. It gives you the feeling of what you have to look for. It tells you what the traps are. and what to say and not say, because certainly we expect you to talk to the police. We're not going to say don't do that, but how you talk to the police is the key to everything.
Amen.
Let's get back to our Center for Disease Control gun report. The next point that was brought up, and this one I love because I think gun buybacks and turn-ins are stupid beyond words. Okay? Dumb cannot even begin to describe it, and yet it seems here in the Los Angeles area, it seems like they're doing them every other month.
Yeah.
And stuff. So you would think, well, good heavens, they spend lots of money and they get a lot of guns. It must do something to reduce gun violence, doesn't it? Well, not according to the CDC. Gun buyback turn-in programs are ineffective in reducing crime. There's empirical evidence that gun turn-in programs are ineffective, as noted in the 2005 NRC study, Firearms and Violence, a critical review. For example, in 2009, an estimated 310 million guns were available to citizens in the United States. And that was a report written by a gentleman by the name of Krause in 2012. But the buyback programs typically recover less than 1,000 guns. Okay, so let's compare 310 million to 1,000. Yeah, I can't do a number that small. On the local level, buybacks may increase awareness of firearm violence. However, in Milwaukee, Wisconsin, for example, guns recovered in buyback programs were not the same guns that are most often used in homicides and suicide. And that was a gentleman by the name of Kuhn, K-U-H-N, who wrote that report in 2002. So in other words, they're turning in the ineffective, useless guns to get the money or the groceries or whatever else they get, but they keep the bad guns to use on the streets the way they want to use them. So that doesn't do good. The next thing that we have here that is really interesting is that stolen guns and retail gun show purchases. Now, bear in mind that both CATS and the Center for Second Amendment Study spends a lot of time at gun shows. Why? We're teaching something that gun owners should know. Obviously, we're trying to make a few bucks off of it. We charge for the class and stuff. Hopefully, we can get where we can at least pay our overhead for it. But it certainly is why we are at all of the local gun shows, and we're going to be expanding those shortly. So you think, well, goodness, if a guy can just walk into a gun show and buy a gun, well, that's terrible. And they said, well, guess what? That accounts for very little crime. More recent prisoner surveys suggest that stolen guns account for only a small percentage of the guns used by convicted criminals, according to a 1997 survey of inmates. Okay, these are actually, they're talking to the bad guys to find out this information. Approximately 70%, more than half, of the firearms used were possessed by criminals after their arrest came from either family, friends, drug dealers, street purchases, or underground market. Okay, so it didn't come from stealing them from the house, and it didn't come from gun shows. One of the things I find absolutely fascinating at gun shows is here you have several buildings full of thousands of firearms, hundreds of people, all with access to guns and ammo, and two uniformed officers walking through providing security. Now, why do we have two uniformed officers providing security when they're surrounded by tens of thousands of guns and a half a million bullets, and it doesn't seem to bother them in the slightest? The next point that we have is that the vast majority of gun-related deaths are not homicides. And let me say that again so that we understand the import of that statement. A homicide is when one person shoots and kills another person. Okay, if it's a justifiable homicide, then it's legal. If it is manslaughter or murder, then it's obviously an illegal homicide. It is the duty of the coroner or the medical examiner to figure that out. And that's all he does. Is this a homicide or is it accidental? That's what their job is. It then goes to the police, and after that, police to the prosecutors, and they determine that. So what they said is the vast majority of gun-related deaths are not homicides. Mm-hmm. Well, the anti-gunners make you think that people are getting gunned down every day and there are all this mass homicides and dead bodies everywhere in the street, and that isn't what it is. The vast majority of firearm deaths are suicides.
Mm-hmm.
Between the years of 2000 to 2010, firearm-related suicides significantly outnumbered homicides for all age groups and annually accounted for more than 61% of the more than 335,000 people who died from firearm-related violence in the United States.
Mm.
Now, here's what's important about that number. First of all, if 61% of that number is suicides, I'm not exactly sure how gun control is going to prevent suicides. Okay? If worst comes to worst, they're going to stick a potato in the exhaust pipe of the car, start it up, roll the windows up, die of carbon monoxide poisoning, and leave the world that way. Obviously, the advantage of suicide by firearm is, I guess, it's very quick. I always wondered if you heard the blast before you went black, but I don't know. And stuff. I was shot once, but I didn't go unconscious. I did hear the blast, and I ran like hell, but that's another story for another day. So if you look at the 61% number applied to the 335,000, then what that tells you is that less than 150,000 events are criminal homicides, but we're in a country that has 310 million firearms. Okay, if you put down a period and a whole bunch of zeros after that period, and you finally get to three or four, that is the minuscule percentage of the number of firearms that are being illegally used for homicides. So what they're saying is we want to have this immense enforcement system that is going to take care of 1/10,000th of 1% of illegal use of firearms.
Unbelievable.
Might be a better way to use the tax money.
Yeah, I understand that.
Bearing in mind that the tax money that was used in this CDC report was $10 million.
Ladies and gentlemen, we're talking about the CDC gun report. We're talking about the idiosyncrasies, if you will, of this whole concept that all we got to do is pass more gun laws, all we got to do is get rid of the guns, and we're going to solve a lot of problems. Well, we don't. We know that we end up with a lot more problems, and we know that to be a fact now that we see this report. And we're going to be talking about some other things here toward the end of the program. What we want you to know that we're going to be telling you about some things that are happening later in the week. We want to give you a little report on our dear friend Kent Hovind down in Florida. But before we do, Brother Stephen, if you would, go ahead and just sort of wrap up with a couple points, your CDC gun report, and then we'll spend the last few minutes talking about Kent Hovind and talking about some things we're going to be doing in the next few days. Go ahead with that.
Well, that led to a really two interesting conclusions, and in addition to the CDC report, we're also going to talk very quickly about an FBI report because its conclusion was stunning. In the CDC report, what Guns and Ammo made a very interesting observation of is what are the opponents, anti-gunners, of the Second Amendment doing about this new data? Perhaps predictably, they're ignoring it. President Obama, Michael Bloomberg, and the Brady campaign have absolutely remained silent.
Yes.
Okay. Most suspiciously of all, various media outlets are also eagerly saying, oh, this is it, man, we're going to get this report, this is going to be great. And when the CDC research came out looking the other way, they decided to ignore it.
Well, that's why we bring these kind of reports on the Wiley Drake Show, because we're not afraid to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, so help us God. Whether it has to do with child taking away or whatever it happens to be, we're going to tell the whole news. And this CDC gun report makes it very clear that what they were wanting to say with it was going to prove that guns were bad and people were bad and all of those kind of things. And it did not do that. And guess what? You only hear about it on the Wiley Drake Show now. You don't hear about it on CNN, which means certainly not the news, or other places. But go ahead.
The conclusion of this article that did a very good job of summarizing the report is the CDC report is overall a blow to Obama administration's unconstitutional agenda. Can I hear an amen on that?
Amen. Amen.
It largely supports the Second Amendment and contradicts common anti-gun arguments.
Mm.
Unfortunately, the mainstream media failed to get the story they were hoping for, and their silence on the matter is a screaming illustration of their underlying agenda.
Mm. Amen. Well, you're absolutely right. And when we talk about agendas, there's a great deal of agendas out there that we fight. One of those is that we have a man down in Florida that's been in prison for 8 years, and he did absolutely nothing wrong except wrong in the eyes of the IRS. And we certainly know that we're going to do everything we can to help. Now, on the 20th, which is Friday of this week, we're going to do another one of our boots on the ground and prayer in the air. Now, boots on the ground is going to be down there in Florida. And if you'd like to be there, it's at 1 North Palafox, P-A-L-A-F-O-X, Street in Pensacola. That's where the courthouse is. And we want you to be there to pray and to be boots on the ground. Now, if you can't be there, you can indeed join us prayer in the air. And that's that phone number I gave you earlier, 712-432-1690. And put in your access code, 399-430-pound, and you can join us. And that will be starting at 8 a.m. East Coast time, Washington, D.C. time, and that will be on Friday the 20th. Join us, boots on the ground, or prayer in the air. Go there and be at the courthouse and call in and say, hey, I'm here. I'm boots on the ground. Or just call in and say, well, I can't be boots on the ground. I will be prayer in the air. And that number again is 712-432-1690. Access code 399-430-pound. And we would encourage you to be a part of that. Now, tomorrow, we're going to have a fellow by the name of Jules. He's going to be on, and we hear a lot of stories about children that have been taken away. We hear a lot of stories about tragic results. We're going to hear a story tomorrow that was as tragic as any child takeaway has ever been. But the end of the story, the rest of the story, as our friend Paul Harvey used to say, is this man fought hard, he fought long, he wrote a book, and he has his children back. And so we had a victory there, and he's going to be sharing that with us tomorrow. And I hope that we'll be on the 9 o'clock show tomorrow, and we would encourage you to listen in and call in and ask him questions. His name is Jewel, and he'll be on with us tomorrow. He'll be sharing with us at 9 o'clock. He'll actually be here in the studio, and he'll be in the seat that Mr. Stephen Davis is occupying right now. Yes, ma'am.
How many years did he fight to get his children back?
Over 8 years.
8 years.
8 years he fought to get his child back. And he's written a book, We Have Your Daughter. If you'd like to get the book, you can go on Amazon, you go all the places. It's called We Have Your Daughter. Go and get that book, and we're going to be talking about his book, and we're going to be discussing the fact that sometimes, we had a lady call in a little while ago, she wants to talk about her case, and I want to hear about her case. But unfortunately, ladies and gentlemen, sometimes we have other things we have to do other than that, and that was the case today. But if you have a case and you want to talk about it, please get in touch with me. Email me at wileywiley@hhe.net. Or call me, wileywiley@hhe.net, or call me on 714-865-8132 and get your report to us. Ladies and gentlemen, we cannot solve your problem, but we can take your case to the court of public opinion, and that's what this show is all about. And this report is not going to be heard on the other news media, I'll tell you that right now. But you hear it here on the Wiley Drake Show, because we want you to know the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth. And Jesus said, if you find out the truth, if you learn the truth, it will indeed literally set you free. We've got about 8 or 9 minutes left. Anything else?
Yes, I have two quick points.
All right, go right ahead.
The FBI every year releases a report on crimes, violence, and the like. And that's surprisingly one of the big things they do. They released a report after the Columbine shooting, and they came to a very interesting conclusion. It turns out that it generally takes 3 minutes or more for law enforcement to get to an active shooting scene. And the difficulty with that is that's not fast enough to save a lot of lives. Look at the Aurora, Colorado shooting and stuff. So what the FBI did, and now bear in mind, this is the Federal Bureau of Investigation. It is a division of the United States Department of Justice. And so you'd think that because it is the major investigative arm of the federal government, that they would be kind of more pro the government's line on this. Unfortunately, for everybody that is anti-gun, they came up with this conclusion. Another important action that civilians take to try to protect themselves during the 3 or more minutes that it takes the police to arrive. Citizens need to be trained on what to do if one of these attacks occur. The variety of resources are available at no cost. In other words, they're telling your local police departments, start training your citizens on how to deal with that. And I'm certain that that includes arms.
Amen. Amen.
The last thing that we're going to talk about before we take the phone calls is CATO. CATO, C-A-T-O. They are an internationally known research facility, the CATO Institute. The CATO Institute did a report on armed self-defense and what goes with it. Their conclusions are even more stunning than the CDC report, if you can believe that. And it is absolutely pro-citizens armed and protecting themselves and the public from all sorts of bad guys. As you know, one of the horrors that we saw today was Coptic Christians, 24 of them, led out of the beach and beheaded by a bunch of really not nice people in black pajamas. I have a sneaking suspicion they probably didn't have self-defense firearms when that happened.
That's right.
And stuff. So as a result, the CATO report, get educated on it, take a look at that. Certainly go to our website at the LLGESQ.com. Take one of our classes. We look forward to seeing you. You certainly want to take one of the CATS class. You made the decision to use a gun. And at this time, I invite the audience to give us phone calls and ask any questions on the subject they wish.
All right. Anybody on the line that would like to ask Mr. Stephen Davis or myself a question? Any questions?
Pastor Wiley, I'd like to interject this. It's interesting that this has come up as well with the firearms. My ex-husband is a firearms enthusiast, and he always kept his, I don't even know what they're called, I'm not into guns too much, but he would keep them in a safe, and in our court report, or in our, you know, the police report saying that they were all out and loaded and there was no locks on them, which is an absolute lie, and they took my ex-husband's guns from him. Like, that's one of the first things they did. So basically they came into our home, disarmed us, you know, put him in cuffs, put him in the car, you know, without charging him with anything. So basically, you know, it was just, you know, I would call it racketeering when it comes to coming into our home and disarming us and taking our children from us.
We have a solution to that problem, but you'd have to come to the class to learn it.
Well, he actually had, we went to a lot of trouble with this because, well, my ex-husband has a restraining order against him between him and the boys, which is absolutely bogus. But we actually went up to another state 2 states away, and we transferred all of the firearms into a family member's name and then had a piece of paper from the, you know, the place that you do that at, the firearm place, and brought that to the court to try to satisfy the court that he does not have any firearms. And, I mean, we drove all the way up there, all the way back. We took 2 trips up there, like a 18-hour drive, just to try to get these kids home, and that, you know, to no avail. But this also reminds me of, you know, all the police shootings that are going on right now. And I did some research last summer, and I came across what's called Homo Saucer, I believe. I might be saying that right. It's H-O-M-E-R, and then S-A-C-E-R, which means the accursed sacred man. Basically, it's an obscure figure from ancient Roman law, whom anyone can kill without committing a crime, but who may be sacrificed. An example, an outlaw. Homo Saucer inhabits the threshold of the political realm by being included within the law, only by being abandoned by profane and divine law. basically they are able to suspend it as the sovereign exception, and so that insofar as subjects are exposed to legal homicide, such as extrajudicial execution, under the state of exception, sovereign power produces bare life, and the sovereign sphere is the sphere in which it is permitted to kill without committing homicide and without celebrating a sacrifice. A sacred life that is life that may be killed but not sacrificed is a life that has been captured in that sphere. Mm-hmm.
Well, Wendy, thank you so much for sharing that, and we're running out of time here, and I need to close out with just sort of let you know what's going to happen tomorrow and the next day or two. Tomorrow, we're going to have a lady on. We talked about the scripture that you said you liked about Jesus said, arm yourself. If you don't own a sword, go get one, and we certainly know that that is true. But tomorrow, we're going to have Joy Lamb on. She has a book called The Sword of the Spirit, the Word of God. And she's going to be talking about the Bible and how it is a sword in not only defense but offense as well for us. So come on tomorrow morning at 9 o'clock and hear Joy Lamb. Dear sweet lady, she's going to be sharing her book that's entitled The Sword of the Spirit, the Word of God. And then Jules is going to be on Thursday, and he's going to be talking about a winning case. A case that was devastating, like many of them are, for a long time. But he hung in there. He did everything he could, and he hung in there, and he won. And we want you to hear that story tomorrow as well.
Wait, you said tomorrow, and you said Thursday.
No, I'm sorry, Thursday. Tomorrow, Joy Lamb is on.
My mother and I are planning on going out there Thursday morning to meet Rapid Jules. I wrote about Jules in my first article in the White House Press.
Yeah, Jules will be on Thursday morning, and I'm sorry I'm confusing everybody. Jules will be on Thursday morning at 9 o'clock, and Joy will be on tomorrow morning at 9 o'clock with the Sword of the Spirit. And then we're going to wrap the week up. We've got a guy by the name of Alan Anthony coming on. We're going to have singers and musicians here in the studio. We're going to wind up with a musical end for the week and praise the Lord together and share the Lord together. And we try to do that from time to time, and we're going to be doing that on Friday as well as the prayer line, the boots on the ground, the prayer in the air.
I have a closing comment.
All right, closing comment.
One of the things that drives the liberal progressive Democrats insane is that the rights that are referred to in the Bill of Rights are God-given, not man-given.
That's right.
And so the Second Amendment is the God-given right to protect yourself, which is why I cited the Luke. So that is what drives them crazy, because obviously they don't want to either A, think there's a God, or B, they don't have authority over God. Mm. So we are talking not about civil, citizen, private person rights. We're talking about God-given rights that the government cannot take from us as much as they may like to.
Amen, amen. Well, they are God-given, and we are at the end of our program now. Time has gone by in a hurry, and I want to thank Brother Stephen Davis for being here. I want to thank you for your comments, those on the air, and please come back tomorrow morning at 9 o'clock California time, 12 noon there in Washington. And remember, the theme for this program is based on the Scripture, Micah 6, and Matthew 23:23 both say, do justice, love mercy, and walk humbly with God. Good night, and God bless.